I want you to stand with me one more time. We're going to welcome Pastor James Kato from Kampala, Uganda, Jesus Worship Center. We love you, Pastor James. Come on and preach to us this morning. We are so thankful that you're here today.
Thank you. I love you, man.
Love you too.
Thank you very much. You may be seated, please. It's a joy and great honor to worship with you this morning, thanking God for what God is doing amongst you. I love the warmth of the fellowship. I love the spirit in this house. I love the hunger, the desire for God. And please nurture that and let it get bigger, not smaller. Amen. We thank God for that. This morning, I want to preach out of Mark chapter 5. If you can find your way to Mark chapter 5, that is where we're going to be hearing the word of God. From Mark chapter 5, we're going to begin from verses number 21. Mark 5 and verses 21. Let's stand for the reading of the word. And when Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered about him, and he was beside the sea. Then came one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name. Seeing him, he fell at his feet and implored him earnestly, saying, "My little daughter is at the point of death. Come lay your hands on her so that she may be made well and live." And he went with him. And a great crowd followed him and thronged about him. And there was a woman who had a discharge of blood for 12 years and who had suffered much under many physicians and spent all that she had, was no better, but rather grew worse. She had heard the reports about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his garment. For she said, "If I touch even his garments, I'll be made well." And immediately the flow of blood dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. And Jesus, perceiving in himself that power had gone out from him, immediately turned about in the crowd and said, "Who touched my garments?" And his disciples said to him, "You see the crowd pressing around you, yet you say, 'Who touched me?'" And he looked around to see who had done it. But the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling and fell down before him and told him all the truth. And he said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." Father, we come to you. We ask that your word will come to us. We cannot hear unless you open us up to hear. So, Father, we ask that you open us body, spirit, and soul, and make a deposit of your eternal word in our hearts. Open our eyes to see, open our ears to hear, open our hearts to receive. Not only shall we receive by faith, but we want to receive intelligently. And we also want to receive experientially your word, your eternal word, your ever-powerful word. Father, please unfold the power of your word to affect every facet of our being. Touch our bodies this afternoon. Touch our homes. Touch our families. Touch our marriages. Touch our children. Touch our businesses. Whatever we are up and about. Stretch forth your hand to heal and deliver. Father, we come against every opposition. We come against every demonic activity. We come against every bondage. We break every yoke even this day in the name of Jesus. We declare every demonic spirit you are subdued. You are arrested in the name of Jesus. We release the light of your glory this day. Father, I pray even as we gather together to worship and to receive your word, visit Denison, visit Sherman, visit this entire county, visit the state of God of Texas, visit America in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, I pray even as we lift up our hands this morning, we declare America belongs to God. America belongs to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. We declare that the Lord will have his way in America. We declare that the redemptive purposes for which this nation was formed are going to be realized. We declare that every prophetic word declared upon this nation is going to come to pass. Father, we bless America. I stand as an African
America, and I bless America. Thank you for the help that America is to us, God. Whenever we've been hungry, whenever we've cried, whenever we've been hopeless, America has come to our rescue. And Father, I bless America that there will be life in America, there will be health in America, there will be joy in America. The generation of the Americans will be happy. Lord, I bless the pride of this nation. America has taught the nations to lift up their heads and to stand tall. So Father, I pray that nothing will cause them to bow down their heads in the name of Jesus. America, I declare in the realm of the spirit that shame is not your portion. Glory is your portion. Strength and power is your portion. Heavenly Father, I pray, even concerning the presidential campaigns, I commit it all to you, God. Father, your word declares that the Lord is cast in the lap, but the decision is of the Lord. Father, I pray in the mighty name of Jesus, in your sovereignty, guide everything happening, God. Father, I pray that place the right man in the White House, in the name of Jesus. I pray the purposes of God to continue to unfold, even for this nation. I send no to every threat. I send no to the enemy. I send no to terrorism. I send no to anything that will tear this nation asunder. I send no to it in the name of Jesus. Lord, I bless America. Lord, I bless Denison. I bless this part of America with your favor and with your goodness. Continue to prosper us and cause us to love you and to serve you. And everybody said amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. You may be seated, please. I really strongly feel that America is a blessing to the nations. I really feel that America is ordained by God, was founded by God, and there are redemptive purposes for this nation. Listen, this is not part of my message, but every nation has been ordained for a reason. Every nation has been ordained for a reason. And America has a part to play in the nations of the world. And in this generation. And so we pray for you and we bless you in Jesus' name. I want to preach this morning about obtaining what the Lord has for you. Obtaining what the Lord has for you. Receiving from God what the Lord has for you. Mark chapter 5, verses number 21 to 34 speaks about four main things, and I'm going to go through them quickly and then we shall pray together. The first thing you see in this story is the case of the miracles. Mark chapter 5 talks about three main cases of divine intervention. The first one is that of deliverance. A demoniac of Gadara, a man who was full of demonic spirits oppressing him. He had a legion of them. That's a minimum of 3,000. And they were oppressing him. The Bible says he used to cut himself with stones. They used to tame him and he could tear the chains asunder. He was living in the tombs. He was crying and howling all the nights. And Jesus walked to him and he delivered him. So that's the first miracle story you find in Mark chapter 5. The second one is that of healing that I'm going to be teaching about shortly. A lady who was sick for 12 years and all she did was to touch the hem of Jesus' garments and she was made whole. And then the last one is a miracle of resurrection. A young girl, 12 years old, died and Jesus called her back. He said, Talitha kumai, which means little girl arise, and she arose. So the whole chapter is full of the miracles of God. What does that talk about? It talks about that the God you and me serve is a God of miracles, signs, and wonders. Your Redeemer, your Savior, your God, the God you worship, the God you love and serve, is a God of miracles, signs, and wonders. Listen, your theology must be miracle inclusive. What does that mean? You can't afford to believe things about God and not believe in his miracle capacity. And you need to believe it in such a way that you know that any time God can perform a miracle, anytime. I was coming from a missionary trip. This is about 7-8 years ago. I was seated on the plane. We were flying into Turkey, Istanbul. And I was seated with a lady, a Korean lady. Her name is Yona Kim. And seated close to her, we had only two seats on that side. She was next to the window, and I was next to the aisle. And we began to chat. And when the time to sleep came, I reclined my seat, ready to sleep. And I noticed that she stayed in her seated position. So I spoke to her and said, "Aren't you going to sleep?" She said, "I can't." I said, "Why?" She said, "I have a back pain." Then I told her, "I have some painkillers. I can help you with them." And then she says, "No painkiller works on me." And I said, "What?" She said, "For years I've had this back pain." So I realized that was an opportunity for me to preach the gospel to her. So I began to talk about Jesus, what he came for, what he died for, the blood he shed, the sin he carried on our behalf. And she began to tear in her eyes. And then I said, "Do you want me to pray for you to receive Jesus?" We are high, about 33,000 feet in the sky. So she said, "Yes, pray for me." So I said, "Okay, close your eyes." And I laid her to the Lord. And the Lord graciously saved her. Then I told her that the same Lord who has saved you, he has the power to heal you. So can I pray for you for healing? She said, "Yes." So I said, "Place your hand on your back." We are on the flight, flying. And so we begin to pray. I command the pain to leave her back. And then at the end of the prayer, I said, "Amen." She said, "Amen." She never told me anything. And so we parted company in Turkey. She was going to Brazil. I was going back to Uganda. 6 months afterwards, I remember where I was. I was in the nation of Rwanda, teaching pastors in the pastors' conferences. I do that every year. And I received this email. And the email was saying, "Dear James, I don't think you remember me. But I am the lady that sat next to you over 6 months ago. And you prayed for my back. I want you to know that since the day you prayed for me, my back has never hurt again. I want you to believe that your God is a God of miracles anytime. He's a God of signs and wonders. Your theology must be miracle inclusive. I don't know about you, but I grew up in a church where they never believed in the works of God, where we never saw God do anything. Not because he wasn't able, not because it wasn't in scripture. But those who led us never taught us about the miracle propensity of his divinity. We need to be people who believe that God is a miracle worker. He's a God of signs and wonders. Our God performs miracles of healing. Our God performs miracles of deliverance. Our God performs miracles of promotion, miracles of provision, miracles of debt cancellation, miracles of restoration, miracles of salvation. 2 years ago, we had a mission in Kampala in a town called Hoima. And part of that mission was to preach the gospel door to door. What does that mean? You knock on people's doors and you say, "Hey, we are here. We are evangelists. We are carrying the good news. Do you want to hear?" They say, "Yes." You preach Jesus to them. Then you ask them, "Do you want to receive Jesus?" They say, "Yes." You pray a prayer for them. And on that mission, as we are doing door to door evangelism, a team from us went to visit with a lady. And this lady's name was Martha. Martha was ready to commit suicide. She had been an alcoholic for a long time, and she was sick and tired of her life. And she wanted to buy poison so that she drinks it so that she kills herself. However, she didn't have the money to buy the poison. All she had in her possession was a pig that she was raising for her. So she wanted to sell the pig so that she gets money out of her pig so that she can buy the poison. Whenever the buyer came to buy the pig went missing on 3 occasions. Whenever the buyer came, the pig went missing until the Lord graciously saved her. I want you to understand that our God can pursue you until he saves you. Our God can pursue you until he redeems you. Our God can chase you until he forgives you. Our God can chase you to give you a better life. Ours is a healing God. He's a saving God. He's a delivering God. He's a restoring God. He's a reconciling God. What are the miracles of God for? The miracles of God are acts of his love and his kindness. The Lord never performs miracles to show off. The Lord performs miracles to show that he loves us and is kind to us. I spoke to a wonderful gentleman in the morning service. The Lord healed him this morning. And he told me his story this morning. He said many, many years ago, working in Oklahoma, he fell off a truck. He hurt his back and he had 30% disability in his body. He said he's been living in pain. Even this morning he came in pain. 4 a.m. when I woke up to pray, the Lord told me there will be somebody in that service with this condition. So in the morning service, I call out this condition. The man comes with faith in the Lord, and the Lord heals him. Because our God is a miracle-working God. And when he touches his children, he's showing, I love you, I know you, and I want to reveal my kindness to you. The miracles of God are miracles of companionship. Whenever the Lord touches you, he's saying, I am in touch with your situation. I know where you are. I know what you are going through. I know your pain. I know your tears. I know your questions. That's why I'm coming to help you. When God performs a miracle, he's saying to us, I'm not far away in heaven. I am in your life. I am in your world. I'm in your environment. I am in town, and I care about my people. His miracles are to display his power. They are to display his glory. I remember many years ago, over 16 years ago, I was preaching in Uganda in a Muslim area, and there was such opposition in this area. And I talked about Jesus. I talked about the miracle power of God. And the Muslims were sneering at us, mocking. Say, oh, whatever you are preaching is not true. Then I told everybody, lift up your hands. We are going to pray. And I began to pray. I began to cast out devils. And I began to go after healing. I said, Lord, perform a miracle that these people may know that you are real. In that congregation was a Muslim young man called Abdallah. Abdallah had a tumor here on the leg. Everybody could see it. As I was praying, the tumor just disappeared. And Abdallah's and his tumor, his Muslim tumor has gone. And he said, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. Listen, what a display of power. Me and you must be hungry for our God to display his glory. Our God is not like the gods of this world. Our God is eternal. Our God is sovereign. Our God is King of kings and Lord of lords. Our God is above all. And above all, our God is able. The miracles of God, we must trust God for them. And I believe that this is where the Western world is disadvantaged. Why? Because many of you in the Western world, everything is cut out for you. There's an insurance for everything. There are things planned for you for everything. But we in Africa, the only way we know how to live is by a miracle. By a miracle, by expecting God to provide. We believe God for food. We believe God for clothing. We believe God for education. We believe God for sustenance. We believe God for school fees. We believe God for everything. Listen, God has called you and me to begin to trust him to perform the supernatural in our lives. To begin to learn how to ask the Lord for these wonders. I encourage you, my friend, pray to the Lord for wonders in your house. Say, Lord, show us some wonders in this family. Show us some wonders in this business. Because God is a better businessman than you are. God is a better leader than you are. And there are things God wants to give to your family, to give you in your life that will open your eyes to his greatness and to his bigness. Jeremiah 33 and verse 3, the Bible says, ask, call upon me, and I will answer you. And I'll show you great and mighty things that thou knowest not. As you call on the Lord and say, Lord, show me your power. Many years ago, 1990, I began to seek the Lord. I used to go in the forest and pray and stay there all by myself, pray, seek the Lord. What was I praying for? I said, Lord, I want to know your power. I want you to use me. I want you to make me a preacher. I want you to visit me. It was in those nights when I was alone in the forest that I began to sense the hand of God on my life. I could feel the hand of God literally on my head. And I could open my eyes and there's nobody touching me. And I began to sense the reality of God. Listen, we have to cry out to God and say, Lord, I want to see your power. I want to see your wonders. I want to see your miracles. I want you to see you at work in a divine way, in an infallible way, in a way that nobody else can ever reject. You at work in my life. We need to ask God for these wonders. We need to walk in expectation. David says in Psalm 27 and verse 13 that I would have fainted unless I believed to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Expectation is central to thriving living. If you want to live normally, if you want to live a boring life, move in no expectation. But you're not cut out for that. You've been redeemed to move and walk and live in expectation. I want you to believe God for a good day, for a good month every month. This month is my month. This month is going to be a good month. This year is going to end well with me. I want you to declare always in your spirit and with your mouth that it will be well with my family. It will be well with my children. It will be well in my body. It will be well in my finances. And move in that expectation. Acts chapter 3, John and Peter, they heal a crippled man and they get beautiful. But the reason they heal this man, the Bible says they saw him looking at them expecting to receive something. And they tap into that expectation to release a miracle. God is waiting for expectation in your heart. Listen, expectation is the breeding ground for the miraculous. If you can afford to move and walk in expectation, there is no limit to what the Lord will do. I remember this story. I think it was told by Jesse Duplantis. Some of you know him. He's a preacher in America. He said that he went before the Lord and he asked God for $50,000. And he said, Lord, I'm believing you. I need $50,000. God being the God he is, he graciously provided $50,000 to Jesse Duplantis. And God said, I've given it to you because Oral Roberts has also been here asking for $1 million. And I've given it to him. And then Jesus said, oh, I wish I'd asked for more. Listen, friend, all over the world, your same God that you have, your same God that you serve other people, I'm asking him for greater things. I'm believing him for greater things. God wants us to move in expectation because God is a God of miracles, signs, and wonders. Mark chapter 5, number 2, talks about waiting on the Lord. The Bible talks about this lady for 12 years. She was waiting for her miracle. She had suffered. She had seen many doctors, but she was nothing better. And she kept on waiting for over 12 years. Understand, God could heal her in a day. But the Lord, in his wisdom, he kept her waiting. Graham Cook, the prophet, has said that what God can stop in his power, he permits in his wisdom. So the Lord permitted her to wait according to his wisdom. Because waiting is what will go through me and you. Somebody here today is waiting for a change in their status. Another person is waiting for them to get married, to have a wife or to have a husband. Another person is waiting for them to conceive, to have a child. Another person is waiting for financial breakthrough. Another person is waiting for God to help them break that addiction in their lives. Another person is waiting for a healing. Me and you are always in this season of waiting for something that we desire to happen to us. And although God has the power to do it in the day, he blesses us with this waiting period. And what is the waiting for? I want to give you two reasons. Number one, the waiting is for your growth and for your development. Because it's in the period of waiting that your selfishness is revealed, that your unbelief is revealed, that your spiritual immaturity is revealed, that your panic capacity is revealed, that your impatience is revealed, that your anger is revealed. And listen, what happens inside you is more important to God than what happens to you. So God desires to refine you, that from glory to glory, you grow into the likeness of Jesus. And he allows you to wait, that he makes you a better person. Because listen to me, the character that God forms and forges out of you is what will help you to keep what God is giving you. If God gave you a miracle today, minus the character to maintain it, you're going to lose it in 1 week. But if you get the character to maintain what God gives you, that thing, that miracle, that blessing, that deliverance is going to be in your life for a long time. So the waiting is for the growth and for the development. When you are in a time of waiting, the wrong question to ask is, Lord, why don't you do it for me now? Why me? Why is it me that has to cry? Why me? Why me? And many of us ask that wrong question. That's the wrong question to ask when you are waiting. The right question to ask is that, Lord, what are you doing in my life? How are you changing me? How am I encountering you? What are you transforming in my life? That's the right question to ask. The waiting is for your growth and your development. But secondly, I also believe that the waiting is for you to find the Lord. We wait for our breakthroughs, that in that time of waiting, we may get to know the Lord better than what you have ever known him. The lady who was in pain, hemorrhaging every day for 12 years. The Bible says she met many doctors, but she wasn't healed. Why? Because she hadn't met Dr. Jesus. And she got healed 3 years earlier. There was no reason she was going to come to Jesus. And many a time we are in this waiting span because the Lord wants us to encounter him. He wants us to know him. He wants us to see him. He wants us to grow in the revelation of who he is. The waiting is tailored to reveal Jesus. Number three, Mark chapter 5 talks about the miracle power of Jesus. We are talking about a woman who had suffered for 12 years. Blood was getting out of her. That meant life. She was losing life daily. The Bible says in Leviticus, the life of a creature is in the blood. And so if your blood is getting out of you, your life is getting out of you. She grew weaker. She became anemic every single day. A lady who could jump, run, and do whatever she wanted to do, now she couldn't stand up anymore. She was bent, stooping down because she was low on energy. Many a time she had to crawl out of her bed to go to the bathroom because of this situation in her life. I imagine her friends had given up on her. Because you see, this disease was one of uncleanliness in that day and in that culture. So people didn't want to touch her for them to become unclean. She had no friends whatsoever. Listen, she had been driven bankrupt because of the disease. The Bible says she sold all that she had. Her clothes, her land, her houses, her everything, her animals. She sold them to get better. But she rather grew worse. What changes the life of this lady is when she touches Jesus. The Bible says she stoops down and touches the hem of his garment. Because in culture, she couldn't stand before a preacher, a rabbi. She had to give him respect by bowing. That's why she touches the hem. But also she bows in worship. She's saying, I'm in pain, but I will worship you, Lord. I'm weak, but I choose to worship you, Lord. It doesn't matter what I'm going through. I will not be stopped from praising you, loving you, believing you, and worshiping you. She bowed down and touched him in worship. She touched the place of power, the hem of his garment. And the Bible declares power came out of Jesus. And Jesus said, power has gone out of me. What happened this time? We don't know. Did he mean he felt dizzy? Did he mean he felt weaker? Did he mean he touched her with some of his power and yet retained all of it? I believe that the Lord touched this lady with both his divinity and his humanity. And the Bible declares this woman who had suffered for 12 years was completely healed. The Bible says that her blood dried up. She felt in her body that she was healed. Listen to this. As the Lord touches you, you feel it first in your body. You feel it first in your soul. You feel it first in your spirit. When God is touching you, nobody outside you feels it. Nobody else outside you knows it. The testimony comes later. It's you and the Lord in that intimate, secret moment when you know that tonight is my night. Today is my day. This service has been called for me. This is the word. The preacher is talking to me. I feel the Lord touching me. That is my miracle. That is my word of knowledge. God is inviting me to heal me. And I feel a change in my life. He has touched me. She felt it in her body. The Bible declares that then she was totally healed. In this story, we see that Jesus is moving power. Jesus is a package of power of the time. He carries healing power. He carries deliverance power. He carries redemptive power. He carries creative power. He carries power of every kind. And I've been sharing with the morning service the stories that I've witnessed firsthand. The first one I witnessed in 1988, I attended an all-night prayer service, and the preacher was praying for the people. He called out a woman with a tumor. He said, "There's somebody here, you have a tumor, stand up." And the lady stood up, she was in brown, and then the preacher prayed for her. I was watching, seeing this for the first time, 1988. And the tumor disappeared. And the preacher asked the lady, "Is the tumor still there?" The lady said, "I don't see it." She almost undressed herself. The tumor was gone. And I said, "Oh my God, where did the tumor go? How did the preacher know there was somebody like that?" And next he called out another word of knowledge. He said, "There's somebody here. One of your legs is shorter than the other. Come." And four girls came out. I saw them. So I said, "Now what is he going to do? These are really badly lame." Then so he said, he sat on the pulpit. He commanded the congregation to stretch their hands towards them and said, "Begin to pray for them." And with my eyes, I watched these girls, their legs grow. He began with the youngest to the eldest. And all of them, as we were watching, the Lord healed them. The Lord wants to know us to know that Jesus has all the power in the world. He has all the power that you need. He has all the power that you need. He is a God of power. He's a Savior of power. And this power is in his name. It is in his word. It is in his promises. This power that Jesus carries, it is real power. It is caring power. It is loving power. It is pursuing power. Another miracle I witnessed, I was interpreting for Todd Bentley about 7 years ago, 8 years ago. He was preaching in Uganda. And a lady comes to this crusade because of cancer. Her breast had been cut off. Mastectomy. She had undergone mastectomy. On this crusade, the breast pops back into existence. And I say, "What? It grew up again." This is how powerful the Lord Jesus is. About 8 years ago, I was preaching. About five years ago, I was preaching in South Africa. On this crusade, the Lord was healing left, right, and center. And on Thursday, a miracle happened. This is how it started. A lady goes into the hospital to give birth. And they declare to her that your baby died in your womb 1 month ago. So we need to operate on you hurriedly because your life is in danger. Now, this lady had gone to the hospital with the mother. The mother said, "No way. We are going to believe God for a miracle." So the mother said, "There is a short black preacher from Uganda. Let us go to his meetings." So they come to the meetings where I was. And that night as I grabbed the microphone, the Lord tells me, "Tell everybody in this house to pray. To pray surrenderedly. To pray loudly." So everybody goes for it. There were about 500 people there. And they pray. And at the end of the 5 minutes, I shout into the microphone and I say, "Amen." And everybody resounds with "Amen." And the lady says at that moment, the baby kicked. When the baby kicked, he wanted out. And the waters broke. So they had to look for the car to take her to the hospital. And even before they took her into the theater, the baby was out. Jesus is that mighty. Jesus is that powerful. Jesus is that greater. I can go on again and again and again and again. The wonders of God, the miracles of God. Preaching many, many years ago in another country, a lady comes with a heart disease. She said, I'm scheduled to see the doctor tomorrow because my heart is bad. I need prayers. And I lay hands on her and she goes back on Monday there. And the doctor said, I'm sorry for misdiagnosing you. There's no more trouble with your heart. God is that powerful that he can erase every evidence of disease even upon you. Come on, clap your hands, all you people, and shout unto God with a voice of triumph. Me and you can go on and on and on retelling about the stories of his wonder working power. This lady, because Jesus has the power all the time, when she touched Jesus, she was healed. And God gave her her voice back. She was given an ability to look into the eyes of Jesus. I want to close with the last one that we see in Mark chapter 5. Because in Mark chapter 5, the Bible says that when she heard of Jesus, she said, I'll go and touch the hem of his garment. So she acted on what she heard. I just imagine this lady, if she had these stories of Jesus and say, I hear he heals people, but for me, I'm sick and doctors can't do nothing about it and I'm going to stay in my home. What would have happened to her? She would have died. Yeah. The game changer was when she chose to act on what she heard. And the message today is the only way you can obtain what the Lord has for you is to act on what the Lord has spoken to you. Information is given to us to be acted upon. Revelation is given to us to be acted upon. Prophecy is given to us to be acted upon. Conviction, dreams, everything God has ever given you, he gives you that word so that you act upon it. I really believe with all my heart that the churches in the world, they are as strong as the members are willing to act on what they have heard. Listen to me, 95% of the members of the churches, they do nothing with their prophecies. They do nothing with their dreams. They do nothing with the messages they hear. They do nothing. And that robs them of the breakthroughs that God has intentioned for them. Are you still following what I'm talking about? I really believe that there is a major breakthrough waiting to happen in your life and in your family. If only you will act on what the Lord has called you to do. A miracle I forgot to tell you about that happened in our church. I don't know, remember, maybe 9 years ago. I was going to teach the leaders in our church Tuesday evening. We had a teacher's class, a minister's class, and I was going to teach the leaders. And as I walk into this meeting, I was late. I'm grabbed by a stranger. This stranger was seated next to the door. And he grabbed my hand and he asked me, are you the pastor? I said, yes. You need to pray for me. I said, can you wait? I need to catch up with those leaders, then I can pray for you. I said, no, I cannot wait. I want you to pray for me now. I said, let my hand go. And he said, no, you have to pray for me. Then I knew I was in trouble. So I sat down on this wooden bench and I said, sir, tell me your story. He said, my skull cracked. And because my skull cracked, pus flows from my brain into my mouth. And I carry this towel wherever I go to spit into it. And he said that I've been dismissed from the main hospital because they said they can do nothing about me. Will you pray for me? The people on this village have told me that when you pray for me, I can get better. Thank God for people who believe in me when I don't believe in themselves, when I don't believe in myself. And so what begins to happen, I lay hands on this man and I pray for him. Hurriedly. I pray for him about 1 minute and then I stood up. He grabbed me. He said, you cannot say a short prayer for a big problem. I have never heard about the theology. You can't say a short prayer for a big problem. Pray again. You know, at times me and you have to be violent. And we have to contend for the things we believe that ought to be ours. And so I said, okay, I really believe God has heard me, but to please you, I'm going to pray again. So I lay my hands on him and I pray again. That was Tuesday. On Sunday, this man was back in a service. He said, I went back to Mulago Rifalo Hospital in Kampala, the main hospital. He said, they have taken x-rays and the crack has got lost. It's not there. He said, the pus is flowing no more. What are we talking about? And this man comes to this church. He comes to find the Lord in this church because many years before he came, I had acted on what the Lord has spoke to me. In 2001, I had a dream. It was in the month of February. I saw Jesus of Nazareth standing in our town. And he pointed where the church is. And he said, James, I want you to build me a church here. I'm going to grow it. I'm going to increase it. The impact of this church is going to be great. In my dream. And I got out of the dream. So I began to walk through that community asking for who has land to sell. And listen, finally when we got the land where the church is, it is in the area where the Lord pointed. And I had to look for the money to buy this land even before the first service of Jesus Worship Center was ever held. In faith, acting on what I'd heard. It wasn't easy. We had no money. We began to gather. Our first service, we are 104 adults. And the Lord began to grow us from that time on. Knowing that his purposes in the different lives of the people that come to this house are going to be unveiled. I'm talking about you acting on what God has spoken to you. Remember when Jesus multiplied bread and fish? It all began with the lunch of a little boy. The disciples bring the lunch of the little boy to Jesus. And he said, Master, this is all we've got. And he said, thank you. He grabs a hold of it and he blesses it and then it multiplies. Listen, your little human action that you're going to do according to what you've heard from the Lord is going to be multiplied by the goodness of the Lord. It's going to be multiplied by the bigness of God. The Lord is waiting on me and you to act on what we've heard. This lady says, I will go and I will touch the hem of his garment. And I know when I do, the Lord is going to heal me. She never had a message. She never had a prophecy. She never had a dream. All she had was stories. You don't have to hear an explicit prophecy. A detailed prophecy. The Lord wants to work with what you have heard so far. In whichever form you've heard it. But as long as you are willing to act upon it, a great miracle, a gigantic miracle is awaiting to happen to you, in your body, in your family, in your business, in whatever you have God working with you. Amen. Are there challenges she encountered? Of course. She had to fight the unbelief. Things, the voices were rising up in her, telling, how do you know that you're going to get healed? You have tried the other doctors. You've done it before. And those are the voices that rise up in our lives whenever we attempt to do something that we've been fighting for. You've done it before. Do you think it's going to work again? Every one of us receives these voices of doubt and unbelief. And for some of us, they're not even whispers. It's as if the devil has a public address system bigger than that of Reinhard Bonnke, blaring into your ears, it can't happen, it can't happen, whoa, it can't happen, whoa, it can't happen. And hear these voices again and again. But listen, you have to act on what you have heard. Did you know that she risked her life being unclean because of her condition? Had they discovered her before she was healed, they would have stoned her. But she said, whether they stone me or not, I'm tired of where I am. I'm going to touch the hem of his garment. She chose to ignore the pain she had to go through. She chose to ignore the price she had to pay. She focused on the end result. She focused on the prize. Me and you, the mistake we make is that we focus on the price and we forget the prize. Imagine how good your life is going to be when that dream, that prophecy, that word, that conviction comes to pass. So ignore all the fears, ignore all the negativities, and press through to do what God has told you to do. As she listened and got herself ready to do what the Lord had told her to do, she pictured exactly what the word that she had never told her that touched the M. But she said, I have to do something. She began to form a picture of what she will do. That teaches me and you that whenever we're listening to the word of God, we need to listen with ears of application. Ears of application. We have to listen with ears of obligation. Every truth God has given you, you are obligated to work it out, to apply it, to begin somewhere with it, and then the Lord will do the rest. How do you get your miracle from God? By acting on what you have heard. By acting on what you have heard. Jesus told the man, pick up your bed and walk. He hadn't walked in 38 years. He acted on what he had and he was healed. Jesus told the man, stretch your hand and be healed. He hadn't done it before. He stretched his hand and the withered hand became whole. Jesus told the woman, bent for 18 years, stand up and unbend your back. And she did. She hadn't done it before in 18 years. We act on what you have heard and God will do amazing things. As I close, I will tell you about our story of touching the community. I was reading a book entitled God, Church at Community, written by Ed Delf. And I heard the Lord say, you have to do something in your community, even through the church. And what the Lord says is that begin a school, build a school for me for the poor children. And so over 8 years ago, I made an announcement in our church and I said, we are going to begin a community school for the poor children, those who cannot have school at all. Our first class was, we had 168 little children between the ages of 3 and 5, a kindergarten school, starting from nowhere. No salaries for the teachers, no scholastic materials, no uniforms. We began the journey. And on the way, little by little, we've seen the Lord pull us through every time. For us, every time is a miracle. Even when things get tough, we know we have to do it because the Lord spoke to us. But God always comes through. And in the last 8 years, we have educated about 600 pupils. A church of our size, a church of our financial status. Can it be done? It can be done by God if people are willing to act on what they have heard. How far is the Lord going to take you? How vast is the world God is going to give you? How many big things is God wanting to release upon you? Act on what you have heard, and you're going to be amazed what the Lord is going to do.